ASP.NET. Using ASP.NET, we are going to build dynamic web pages. Web pages which based on some user input are going to render some output to the browser. But much before we actually get into ASP.NET, it becomes very important that we understand how a web browser and web server communicate with each other, what is the role of HTTP protocol, how does a request get initiated from browser, and what all will happen till it gets the response from the server. Of course, we are never going to directly program all these things ourselves. That means the communication between browser and server is not our responsibility. Rather, it is pre-programmed already in the browser software and the web server software. But having little better knowledge on this, especially from the developer's angle, will only help us in programming ASP or ASP.NET dynamic web pages in a better way. So in a way, I can say that this particular chapter would act as a prerequisite for anybody who wants to jumpstart into not only ASP.NET, but any other dynamic web pages programming. See, all these days you have been using internet as a novice user. It is as good as watching a movie in a theater as an ordinary person. But what is important is when we look at a movie as a director, then the technology, the techniques are what we probably would be more interested in on how that movie is made. So what I'm trying to say is there is surely a difference between how an ordinary person like you and me is going to watch a movie, or how a director of a movie, or maybe a producer or an editor of a movie, a person who is technically associated in making a movie, is going to watch a movie. There is a difference. Likewise, all these days you have been watching or using internet like an ordinary user. But now you are going to play a role of a web developer. In the process, the way you look at the web has to change. The way you understand things when you get the output from the server has to change. You have to get into the technicalities of how the browser and server are going to communicate with each other, and precisely that is what is the target in this particular chapter. So what exactly? Let us start with the very basic things. See, what is internet? Internet is network of network, and on each network we have got many servers. We basically call them as web servers. These are web server softwares which can be hosted by different operating systems, and different softwares are available on each operating system. In context of Microsoft, we are going to have IIS, Internet Information Server. In our case, for development of ASP.NET applications, we are going to make use of IIS as the web server. But like that, there are other web servers by other web vendors. Like we have got Apache web server, we have got Tomcat server, we have got WebSphere, we have got WebLogic. Like that, for different technologies by different vendors on different operating systems, there are different web servers available. What is very beautiful thing is the operation of these web servers is all one and the same for the outside world. Internally they might be working differently, but when it comes to communication with the people over the internet, they all operate in the same way. See, on the client machine you might be using Windows, somebody else might be using Solaris, somebody else might be using Unix, somebody else might be using Macintosh, somebody might be using a tablet, and somebody might be using a mobile device, and different operating system on different mobiles. In all cases, when we want to communicate with web server, we need a web browser software, irrespective of your operating system, basically irrespective of your platform. What is needed on the client is a browser software. And again, there are various choices available in browser software. I might use Internet Explorer, I might be using Firefox, I might be using Chrome, Opera, Safari browsers on Mac, or maybe any other operating system, any other browser based on the operating system which I am making use of. So what is important is, irrespective of the choice of web server on the server and a browser software on the client, the communication between them is all standard. They all communicate in same way. That is basically we need to understand now how these two are communicating, that is a browser and the server are communicating with each other. Precisely this is what is our target now. So let us see this way. Whenever a browser has to submit a request to the server, we are always going to provide a URL. In the browser, we will provide a URL. Say something like this. I would provide http://www.microsoft.com. And on microsoft.com server, we might be interested in something like, let us say, training. And in that, we might be further interested in some file, let's say default.htm or html. I'm just giving a dummy path, don't try to check whether it is existing or not. So let us say a URL looks like this. So in browser we are going to give this as a URL, and we also know that the content of that file is going to be rendered in the browser once we get the response from the server. So yes, a browser will submit a request to internet in the form of URL. Internet will route that request to the web server, appropriate web server. On the server, the request is going to be processed. Server is going to render the output in the form of HTML document, and that response rendered is going to be viewed by the browser in the client machine. This is what you know as an end user, as an ordinary user. But now as a sophisticated user or as a little advanced user of web in the form of web programming, I would prefer you knowing little more in detail. Now, understand that every machine on internet has a unique IP address. Every machine has a unique IP address. Now, what is this IP address made up of? Basically, IP address is made up of four parts: dot, 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 and dot, where each part is going to range in between 0 to 255. So, an IP address can be something like 127.0.0.1, and this is a special IP address, which we also call it as loopback IP address. So every machine like this has a IP address on this machine. On this, it might be 192.168.0.1. So like this, anything. So we don't need to get into those details, but what is important is every machine on internet has a IP address. Now, every web server is supposed to start. Web server software is supposed to start. Basically, what does it mean? IaaS is supposed to start, let us say, in context of in ASP.NET. Now, what does IaaS starting basically means? IaaS starting would basically means that it is now waiting for the request to come. That means it has created a socket and wait for the request to come. Now, what is socket? Socket is a combination of IP address of that machine and some port number. Now, this port number is supposed to be an integer number. And every web server by default waits for a request to come on port number 80. So, not necessary it should be always 80, but that's the default port number which is known to the public. Hence, a web server always waits on the port number 80. So I repeat, a web server has to be started. When the web server has to be started, it creates a socket, and on the socket it will wait for a request to come from the client, which is in our case browser. What is socket? Socket is an IP address of the current machine and random port number. In our case, it will pick up 80, default port number for HTTP protocol. Now, from browser, we are going to provide this URL. But in this, is there any information about the IP address of Microsoft.com? Or is there any information about the port number? No. What is important is, at least when port number is not provided, by default, browser is going to assume that we want to submit a request to port number 80. But alternatively, when we know that the server is not running on port number 80, but if it is running on some other port number, here we are supposed to provide the port number. So you can try putting colon 80 without 80, both you will get the same response. Why? 80 is the default port number. So I repeat, when we know the web server is running on a socket with an IP address and a port number which is not 80, and we know whatever is a port number, that port number will have to provide here in the URL. And generally this is done for non-public websites, private websites or secured websites. They would change the port number. They would not run on port number 80, so that only those people who know the port number would be able to reach those web servers. So anyways, with 80, without 80, there is no difference. So browser knows port number, but where is IP address? Now, on internet, we have got DNS servers, domain naming service. That DNS server basically is responsible for mapping a domain name to IP address. For this domain name, this is the IP address. For all the domain names on internet, there is a fixed entry created in DNS server. So Microsoft.com also has created a domain name. Let's say www.microsoft.com has been mapped to some IP address, some x dot, y dot, z dot, whatever, something. Let's say k. Some IP address, which will be obviously in this particular format. We don't know. Now, what is browser going to do now? Browser, when you submit the request for this URL, first will submit a request to actually DNS server. And from DNS server, for this particular domain name, it will get the IP address. So now browser knows the IP address of Microsoft.com and it already knows port number 80. Onto that socket, basically it now knows IP address as well as port number. So browser also creates one socket on its own machine. On the browser machine, a socket will be created. Through that socket, browser is going to submit a request to the server of Microsoft to the specific IP address and port number of Microsoft. The server on the Microsoft is going to receive the request, and very important, that socket which has received the request is not going to directly connect with the browser. Why? If suppose the socket with port number 80 on server establishes connection with the browser and starts communicating with the client on that particular socket only, all other client's requests are going to get blocked. So to avoid this blocking, every web server is responsible for immediately on receiving a request on port number 80, it creates a new socket on some other random port number. And on that socket, it will connect to the client. Basically, it will accept connection with the client. And then client and server would get connected to each other. So the only thing which is fixed is the port number of the server on which it is going to initially receive the request. And after that, it will switch the client to another socket with a different port number. And on that socket, the server socket and the client socket, and hence the server and the client are connected to each other. Once these two are connected to each other, browser and server are now going to communicate with each other using HTTP protocol. What is HTTP protocol? We will immediately see after this. That means, as per HTTP protocol, server is going to execute this file on server. It will search for that file on the server folder and render the content of this file to the browser. Browser is going to receive this content. But what is important is, as soon as server has rendered the content of default.html to browser, immediately it is going to break the connection with the browser. It will not keep the connection alive. So basically, browser submits a request to server on port number 80. Server accepts the connection by switching the client to another socket on any other random port number. On that socket, it will further receive the request from the client. Complete request data is going to be received from the client. Server is then going to execute the request on server, process the request on server, we call it, render the HTML output to the browser and break the connection with the client. The server does not retain the connection with the client once the response is rendered to the browser. Now browser has received already the required resource from the server. It is going to
independently execute that in the browser machine and render the output on the browser window. So this is the life cycle of one request. And something very important, same thing will happen every time we submit a request for another URL. Every URL which is submitted by browser to server, everything what I said is going to happen again and again. What is important is server, once it renders the output to the browser, forgets everything about the client. It does not remember anything about the client. And hence we say that web servers are stateless. They do not remember any kind of information about the clients once the output is rendered to the browser. So this whole thing in the form of text I have documented here. Web browser, rather HTTP server, waits for the request to come on the socket, the default port number being 80. Web browser submits a request for a given URL after creating a socket in the local process. They also create a socket in the local process. Request is submitted to DNS server so that based on the domain name, IP address is fetched from DNS server. Now browser has the IP address of the server and it knows the port number 80. Browser submits the request to the web server. Server accepts the request and shifts the client to another socket so that the socket on port number 80 is released for the receiving of request from other client. Now browser and server are connected to each other. Browser submits the request as per HTTP protocol. What is HTTP protocol? That is the immediate next topic. Server processes the request, renders the response and breaks the connection. And of course, browser will render the output on the browser window. So this is how every HTTP request is processed on server and output is rendered to the browser. Now let us understand what is HTTP protocol. What is all HTTP protocol about? Protocol. What does protocol basically means? Some rules, some guidelines, some standards. See, this particular term protocol is more often heard in context of politics, where a diplomat of one country when visiting another country, let us say a president of one country when visits another country, he has to follow certain guidelines, certain standards in his whole day schedule. He cannot just deviate from it. Only then it will help all the people around to make proper arrangements. Right from his landing to visiting different locations, even having lunch, dinner, communication with the respective, everything I would say is predefined, and as per that standard only he will have to move around. Precisely, on internet we have got protocols for communication between browser and server, rather any two applications when they have to communicate with each other, for the communication to properly synchronize with each other, there needs to be a protocol. So protocols are of different types. What we know here is HTTP is an application protocol. What does it mean? The browser application and the web server application have programmed certain guidelines for making the browser and server communication properly synchronized with each other. That is why we say it is application protocol. Whereas the other protocol, TCP protocol, that is basically your transmission control protocol, that generally sits at your network layer in OSI. If you are by any chance knowing what is OSI, your TCP/IP sits at network layer, physical layer, right? All those layers are there. Yeah. So network layer is what TCP/IP would sit at. HTTP protocol would sit at application layer. So yes, HTTP is an application layer protocol. What is the role of application layer protocol? This application layer protocol is the one which will provide specification about what are the messages which have to be communicated between client and server. In context of HTTP, what messages is browser going to submit to the server? What is the format of those messages? Is what is the specification? And likewise on server, what is the format of the response which a server is going to render to the browser? So we are going to go into little more depth of this request format and response format. But yes, HTTP protocol is an application layer protocol specifying request and response messages and their formats to be communicated between browser and server. The communication between web browser, web server on internet is done using HTTP protocol. HTTP is a specification by Internet Engineering Task Force and W3C. See this, both the bodies, Internet Engineering Task Force, IETF and W3C are neutral bodies. They are not by Microsoft, they are not by Sun, because internet is a hybrid thing of different platforms. The specifications of internet has to be always neutral. They should not be biased towards any particular platform or any particular technology. So the role of this W3C is to provide neutral specification, to provide platform independent, technology independent specification, which is ideally suitable for all vendors products to communicate with each other. So yes, HTTP is one such specification by Internet Engineering Task Force and W3C, basically initiated by IETF and then acknowledged by W3C. Actually, W3C now plays a very major role in not only HTTP but so many other stuff. HTML is a specification by W3C, XML, JavaScript, not exactly JavaScript, we can say DOM, document of Java, HTML DOM, and so many other specifications are there which W3C provides in a neutral way for the internet industry to work consistently. Otherwise, all these people will simply fight with each other. Microsoft will say my specifications are better, my products are better when compared to Java or Sun, and likewise Sun would say my products are better, and there would not be any standard for communication to happen. So the role of W3C is very important on internet. HTTP protocol is safest protocol to be used on internet. Why? Because the messages which are exchanged between client and server, browser and server in HTTP protocol are in text format. Text cannot have virus. And as long as text is the form of communication, it is considered to be safe. So yes, because it is text and virus free, it is the safest protocol. And most importantly, HTTP is pull based technology. We can pull the content from server, we cannot push the content to the server. From your browser machine, you are able to pull the content of this video, but you cannot push the content from your machine to my web server. Very important. So because it is pull based technology, everything on web server becomes secured. At the same time, server cannot directly access any of the resource on the client machine except what it has to do has to be done through browser. I cannot on the server write a program which will directly access the file system of the client machine. There is no such facility in HTTP protocol. So yes, HTTP protocol protects both the server machine and the client machine so that none of the machines can interfere with the content of the other or corrupt the software or spread virus on it. So yes, if our server and browser are sticking to the default protocol specification, there is no chance of virus spreading. But how is virus spreading on internet then? These are all because of the security holes which are there at times in the browser, or we try to download some content from server and then locally execute that application on the client machine, then only the virus would come. As such, the protocol does not have any facility of spreading virus. Because of the content which we downloaded from the server on executing it on the local machine, yes, there is a chance of virus being spread. So yes, that is important. And then next very important feature, HTTP protocol is stateless protocol. Now what is stateless protocol? I as already explained, web server does not remember any information about the client once the browser is once it renders output to the browser. Every request is treated as the first request. The whole request, that is the reason we don't say in context of HTTP or web browser and server, it is client server communication. We actually say it is request response communication which happens between browser and server. That's how it is termed as. Internet is not client server, though we have got client browser and server IS, but the model of communication is request response, because whatever is going to happen for a given request is also going to happen for the subsequent, I mean first request, second request, third request, all the requests and their corresponding response, the sequence of steps are same, and they are exactly the way I have explained to you in the immediate previous topic. And the current version of HTTP is 1.1, though it came up with 0.9 version and then 1.0, and very soon they introduced 1.1, and since then it is still 1.1 version of HTTP protocol only. So let us now move into understanding what is a request structure and what is a response structure. See, I told you HTTP is the protocol. Now, once I say HTTP is the protocol, what is the format of communication? And moreover, it is an application layer protocol. An application layer protocol is responsible for providing specification about the messages and the format of the messages to be exchanged between client and server. So as a part of that specification, when the request is submitted by browser to server, we say that is a HTTP request structure. And similarly, when the server renders output to browser, we say it is HTTP response structure. So what is a request structure further made up of? A request structure is further made up of request line, request headers, and message body. Similarly, a response structure is further made up of status line, response headers, and message body. So how does a HTTP request looks like? It sends a request which looks like this. Let us say this is the first line. We have got get demo slash default.html slash protocol and the version. This line is referred as request line. Followed by this request line, we are going to have a series of name value pairs. Name, value, name, value. A series of name value pairs will be present. These series of name value pairs are referred as request headers. Now, what are these request headers going to contain? I am going to explain it. Followed by that, we have an empty line, and after empty line, if suppose there is some data to be submitted to server, basically name value pairs, again we are going to have those name value pairs here, which is ampersand separated. Say name value, ampersand name value. So like this, this is posted data, we call it, or we can say it is message body. So yes, all this thing in string format is what a browser is going to submit from browser machine to server machine. I repeat, first line is request line. Thereafter, for every line we have got one pair. Like that, many pairs will be there. All these are referred as request headers. Followed by that, one empty line will be there. And followed by that, you will have a list of name value pairs, which are referred as message body. Message body sometimes will be there, sometimes will not be there. When it is there, when it is not there, I'll explain. Likewise, this is how your response structure will be. Response structure. This is status line. First line is status line. So this is again the response of some protocol. This is called a status code. This is status description. Followed by that, you see again name, value, name, value, name, value. A proper example of name value pairs, which are all referred here as response headers. And followed by that, you will actually not mentioned here, but followed by that one empty line, and followed by that is going to have your content of page. All the content of the page which we see in the browser, we can say that is what we will have here, and that is referred to as message body. So yes, this is how a request line, request header, message body is what a request header comprises of, and a status line, response headers, and message body or page content is what a response header comprises of. So what is this request header? Request line, we understand. We have first part method, which can be get or post. I will elaborate little more on get and post little later, but right now a request line is going to have first get, followed by the path of the file which we are interested in, followed by that the protocol and version. This is what is the request line. Now, request headers are the name value pairs which a browser will submit to the server, and these name value pairs generally contain information about the browser, about the current page, and about the operating system which the client machine has. So all these things we would probably need it on the server. For example, When I'm writing a program on the server, I would want to know whether on the client machine the IP address browser software used is Firefox or whether it is Internet Explorer, and accordingly I want to render the output. For that there is a request header by name user agent, and the value of this user agent on server to me will indicate whether it is Internet Server or Internet Explorer or Firefox browser being used. Like that, in your browser there is a provision where you can specify the language of your choice. Like that, there are so many other things which a browser will submit to the server in the form of name value pair, which a developer on the server would be able to use it for customizing the output for that particular client. And this data which a browser submits to server is in the form of request header. And these request headers are submitted along with every request. It's not like with only one request. With every request, these request headers are submitted by browser to server. Now point is, when they are submitted by browser to server, where are they saved? On server, in the server process, they are again saved as name value pairs. And these name value pairs, when saved on server, are referred as CGI environmental variables. So remember, CGI is basically Common Gateway Interface. It stands for, basically CGI is a specification, and one of the specifications in CGI is responsible for providing names of those variables in which the data submitted by browser will be there. Those variables list will also include the information about the server. So see here, it's a collection of name value pairs including the request headers and the information about the server in context of a given request. The names of these variables are based on CGI specification, and these variables are also referred as server variables. So basically CGI is the one which actually facilitated dynamic execution on the server. So see, browser will submit the request to server, server will invoke a CGI program. This CGI program is going to take data from the CGI environmental variables in the server and would probably sometimes even invoke other programs or files which will be having some input, execute here, give the response to server. Server will then respond to the browser, which is going to be a HTML file rendered in the browser. So CGI played a very important role for making the web pages dynamic. Prior to CGI, there was no dynamism in web pages. They were all static pages. Simply load them, render to browser. No execution on the server. Of course, little more about this I am going to talk when I am working with ASP. Now that we understand what is request header, let us understand what is message body. Now before we actually understand message body, you should know a little bit about form tag in HTML. In HTML, we have got a form tag for which we will provide action, which is supposed to be the name of the file to be executed on the server when the form is submitted. See, in form tag, we are going to have a submit button, and there will be a lot of input elements like text box, button, checkbox, radio, like that, different input elements will be there. Now when I submit the form, basically click on the submit button, the form is pre-programmed in web browser to submit a request to this particular file. And along with the request, it will carry the name and value pair of each and every input element which is there in the form. Of course, I am going to practically demonstrate this when we do ASP, but as of now, I want to actually tell you what is this method part of it. See, the method can be either get or post. So when the form is submitted, by clicking on the submit button, it submits the name and value pair of each and every input element to the server, and it will submit a request for this particular file. Now how are these name and value pairs submitted? That is decided by the method here, which can be either get or post. If the method is get, in such case the name and value pair are submitted in the form of query string. Query string is what? The string which is followed by the question mark in the URL. Say something like this. Suppose we have the URL, question mark, name, value, ampersand, name, value, and so on. So this string is what is called as query string. So name and value pair, which is the input element data, is submitted to server in the form of query string if the method is get. Whereas if the method is post, the same data is submitted in the form of message body here. Here, this is message body. Posted data we call it. In the request structure, posted data we call it. So what is the difference between get and post? In case of get, all the name value pairs are submitted as query string. And because query string is visible in the browser, it is not secured. It is in plain text format and it is visible in the location bar of the browser, it is not secured. Another important limitation which it has is the length of this is limited by the browser. It is not unlimited in length. So when large volume of data has to be submitted, you cannot make use of get. In such case, compulsory you have to use post only. And default method when not mentioned in the form tag is get. So get method is used for submitting the data in the form of query string. Same thing in the post. Post advantage is what? Because it is submitted in message body, it is kind of secured. Length is not restricted. Unlimited amount of data can be submitted using post method. Post method is secured because it cannot be okay. Now, one more major difference between get and post, which generally is difficult to understand, is when to use get, when to use post. See, in simplest language I can say, when you are submitting a request for a page and if the state of the server does not change with the data which is submitted, then in such case the request method used must be get, otherwise the request method used must be post. For example, when you are doing a search on Google, when you type some search keyword and submit to Google, Google sends a response. Does that response change after some searches I make? No, every time we search with that keyword, we get the same response from Google, and Google does not change anything on server based on the input we provided. So in that kind of form data which is submitted, the request method used must be get. But if you are doing something like a poll, every time I submit a poll, based on my input, the poll result would be varying. For that kind of case, the request method used must be post. So if based on the input, the data on the server changes, the request method used must be post. Based on the input, if the request data does not change, the state of the server does not change, the request method used must be get. So that is how get and post are different. And finally, we have got response structure. I told you response structure has status line, status code, and status line, response headers, and message body. Message body is nothing but the content of the page. Response header is the content of server, the information about the server, which probably is needed by browser at times for rendering the content to the browser. It can be some cookies information, or it can be what is the time zone in which server is, because according to that, the time settings on the client has to be adjusted, because server and client need not be in same time zone. How much duration the page should be cached in the browser, caching if suppose enabled, how much duration is the content valid. So all this information will be there in the form of response header. Now what is status line? Status line is made up of status code and status description. So status code is a number which is basically, this is status code and this is status description. Status code is basically a number which browser first receives it as a response from server, and based on this number only, server would know what action to take in response to the browser would know what action to take in response of the response from server. So a 200 number is basically success. 201 means something else. 202 means something else. So like that, we have got a range of number from 200 to 299. Obviously, we don't need to get into the details of each and every number unless we are doing programming of web browser and web server software. If we are programming, then every number it becomes important to us. But as we are not going to program, just the range, what is the range representation, is sufficient. Like that, 100 series is basically information. What it means, we are going to get information about the response, but actual content of the page will not be rendered. Like that, 300 series is incomplete request, where means the request has to be redirected from the original page which is requested is not there. So the server will send a response to submit a request to another page by the browser. So that kind of number. So 302 is the common redirect number which is used. 404 you all very well know. 404 is file not found. Like that, there are other numbers. 401, 402, not authorized, not authenticated, and so on. And 500 series is for any kind of server error. So yes, this is just basic I am giving you, but each number has a meaning based on which the server is going to take an action. Right? So this is how request structure and response structure is. Finally, let us have a brief about what is a web server. A web server has a default directory, and by default on IIS it is c:inetpub:www root. Remember, whenever you are working with web server, only the content of the default directory is what somebody from client can request. So in IIS, the default directory is c:inetpub:www root. So only content which is present in that folder can be accessed by the client. Like that, from browser we are going to submit this request, right? Server name, port number. So this directory content is going to be searched in the subdirectory of www root. So web server expects directory to be present under www root, and under that default.html file to be present. So what is IIS? IIS is a web server. It's a Windows component which will be responsible for receiving the HTTP request and responding to the server. How do you manage IIS? To manage IIS, you have to go to Control Panel, Administrative Tools, and under this we'll find Internet Information Service Manager. Double click on this. And this is going to open the management tool for managing IIS. This is not IIS. This is the tool for managing IIS. So expand this. You'll find the list of websites. I will have only one default website. And under default website, we have different applications. So right click on this. Go to properties. Okay, select this. And here you'll find bindings. HTTP, HTTPS, all these protocols are what? See, HTTP default port number is 80. And IP address star, that means local IP address it is going to pick up. And here you can find basic settings. Default, C:, system drive is your C:, inetpub, www root is the default directory. Physical path where the content is present. So yes, as we move forward into programming, we are going to explore more about the options which are available here. When we do ASP.NET, all this will become important. So alternatively, you can just go to run and type inet manager. From here, just type inetmanager.exe, and that will also open the same tool. So you can go to Control Panel, Administrative Tools, IIS Manager, or inet manager. And I have shown you already there is a default website. Yes, you can have multiple websites in IIS. We are not so much interested about that aspect. So concluding this chapter, what I have covered so far is all the things which one would probably want to know as a programmer of web application. Not specifically ASP.NET, nothing about ASP.NET I have covered, but general terminology. Now you understand how a browser and server communicates with each other. What is a HTTP request lifecycle from the time it begins from the browser to server and back to browser? What is the importance of HTTP protocol? In HTTP protocol, what is request structure, response structure? And in request structure, what is the difference between get and post method used in the form tag? So this is all what I have covered in this particular chapter. Thank you.